At 6:01 a.m. on May 19, 1965, NASA engineers launched a rocket they expected to fail. The goal was simple: trigger an abort, test the system, and recover the capsule. But within 2.5 seconds of liftoff, Little Joe 2 began spinning violently, 335 degrees per second. The booster broke apart at just 12,000 feet, far too low for any normal escape. Trapped in a catastrophic spin, the capsule's emergency systems were now facing conditions they were never designed to handle. The supposed calculated failure suddenly became real and rapidly fell out of control. In 1961, just weeks after Soviet cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first man in space, United States President John F. Kennedy stood before Congress and committed America to their most ambitious goal yet, quote, landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth. The program had the name Apollo, after the Greek god of the sun. NASA manager Abe Silverstein had suggested it the year before, saying the image of a figure racing across the sky in a chariot felt appropriate for the scale of America's latest endeavor. But getting there meant building something that had never been built before, a launch vehicle powerful enough to escape Earth's atmosphere and reliable enough to carry people safely through every second of the climb. Early results weren't encouraging. In 1959, a Juno 2 exploded just 13 seconds after liftoff. In 1960, a Mercury Atlas rocket disintegrated in midair. That same year, a Titan 1 was destroyed after veering off course. The Apollo program would take those risks even further. The rocket was larger, the speeds were higher, and the fuel load was massive. The astronauts would sit in a command module mounted at the very top of the vehicle, directly above hundreds of tons of liquid propellant. If something failed during ascent, there would be no time to eject, and absolutely no way to shut it down. For the project to succeed, NASA needed a system that could pull the crew out before the rocket tore itself apart. They called it the Launch Escape System, or LES. The concept itself wasn't new. It was proposed in 1958 by NASA engineer Maxime Faget and tested during Project Mercury, America's first crewed space program. The original design used a small solid-fuel rocket mounted on a tower above the one-man cone-shaped Mercury capsule, built for short missions in low Earth orbit. Though that system worked for Mercury's light and low-altitude flights, Apollo required something far more powerful. The upgraded LES used a taller solid-fuel tower with enough thrust to pull the command module clear of a fully-fueled Saturn rocket, an enormous multi-stage launch vehicle carrying hundreds of tons of volatile propellant. The system could be triggered automatically if the signal was lost between the capsule and the booster, or manually by the astronauts or launch control. If unused, it was jettisoned early in flight. However, should something fail in the first seconds after ignition, just like an ejection seat on a jet aircraft, the LES was the crew's only chance of survival. Once activated, the system fired in less than a second, yanking the capsule away from the rocket and throwing it high into the air. Small steering fins called canards deployed immediately, flipping the capsule so it faced heat shield first. Finally, a sequence of parachutes slowed the descent for landing. By 1965, the system was mounted, wired, and flight ready. But before any crew could ride with it, NASA had to find out if it worked in the real world. NASA couldn't test the escape system on a real Apollo rocket, especially not early in the program. The risk was too high, and the cost too steep. They built something simpler, the Little Joe 2, a short, squat booster powered by clustered solid-fuel motors. The device wasn't designed to reach space, but rather built for one job only: push a test capsule fast enough to recreate the violent forces of launch, then simulate a failure. On top of it sat a boilerplate capsule, a full-scale, uncrewed replica of the Apollo command module. Together, Little Joe 2 and the capsules gave NASA a way to trigger abort safely and watch the escape system in action, moment by moment, and learn from them. Before they could test these two together, in November 1963, NASA mounted a boilerplate Apollo capsule on a fixed platform in the desert and fired the escape tower directly from the ground. The capsule flipped, spun briefly, then stabilized as its parachutes deployed before touching down safely. Just as expected, the launch escape system had cleared the pad. The next test, A1, added motion when, in May 1964, A little Joe 2 booster lifted the capsule to altitude before actually being destroyed mid-flight. The LES fired into the blast, pulled the capsule clear, and brought it down. For test A2, this time the rocket pitched off course almost immediately, swerving hard before the abort sequence triggered. Even under those conditions, the escape system held. The capsule separated cleanly, and all three parachutes deployed. By the end of 1964, NASA had completed three successful abort tests. The next would aim to push the launch escape system to its limits. On May 19, 1965, at exactly 6:01 a.m., Little Joe 2 lifted off from White Sands Launch Complex 36. That morning, the test plan called for a high-altitude abort at 120,000 feet, where the thin air would challenge the escape system's steering canards, small fins meant to flip the capsule around, deployed into the spin. Within just 2.5 seconds of ignition, something went catastrophically wrong. Suddenly, the rocket began rolling violently to the right. What started as a slight wobble quickly spiraled into an uncontrollable spin of the entire vehicle. Structures designed to handle vertical acceleration now faced sideways loads they were never meant to endure. And with the rocket spinning like a rifle bullet and barely 12,000 feet off the ground, Little Joe 2 started coming apart. From one moment to the next, the aluminum skin buckled and tore. Fuel tanks ruptured as the midsection crumpled inward, aerodynamic forces ripping through the spinning mass. This wasn't the controlled test NASA had planned, but a real emergency, happening in real time, at the worst possible moment. Too low for a normal abort sequence, too fast for manual intervention, and with the entire vehicle disintegrating right beneath the capsule. The abort system fired automatically. In less than a second, the escape tower's motors ignited with 155,000 pounds of thrust, pulling the capsule away from the braking rocket. But the capsule was already spinning wildly, now 335 degrees per second, inherited from the booster below. This created another massive problem with the canards. Normally, they would have worked, but the extreme rotation actually kept the capsule pointing the wrong way, tower first instead of heat shield first. Then the capsule shot upward, still spinning, reaching only 20,000 feet instead of the planned 120,000. Below, Little Joe 2 broke apart, pieces falling across miles of desert. At 11 seconds, explosive bolts freed the escape tower, though part of the protective cover stuck to the capsule as the tower fell away. At 15,000 feet, the drogue chutes fired. Two 16-foot diameter parachutes shot out into the airstream, inflating despite the capsule's apex forward attitude and violent spin. The drogues bit into the air, their lines twisting but holding, gradually slowing the rotation. By 10,000 feet, the capsule had stabilized enough for the main parachute deployment. Three 83-foot diameter orange and white canopies blossomed above the spacecraft. The descent slowed to 25 feet per second. Finally, 5 minutes and 2.8 seconds after the failed launch, capsule BP-22 touched down in the New Mexico desert, 3.45 miles from where it started, completely undamaged. Apollo engineers later examined every frame of film and line of telemetry. The canards had deployed on time. The capsule had flipped. The parachutes had held under violent spin. Every system had fired as designed, even though the conditions were never part of the plan. NASA engineers would later call it the most valuable abort test of the program, not because it went according to plan, but precisely because it didn't. The escape system had saved the capsule from conditions far worse than anything they had dared to simulate. A low-altitude abort from a violently spinning, disintegrating booster. In a real mission, the crew would have walked away. From that moment on, the Apollo launch escape system was considered flight-proven. When Apollo 11 launched in July 1969, this escape system stood ready in case anything went wrong during ascent, the most dangerous phase of the mission. When Neil Armstrong, Buzz Aldrin, and Michael Collins made it back home, they fulfilled the promise Kennedy had made, not just to land a man on the moon, but to return him safely to the Earth. Though it never fired during an actual mission, each astronaut strapped in, knowing that if their Saturn V came apart beneath them, their launch escape system had already proven itself in the wildest of conditions.